agenda item one, which is the preliminary matters. And can I ask any apologies, please?
We've got apologies from Councillor Grace, Chair.
Are there any declarations of interest?
We haven't received any.
There's no matters of urgency on the agenda, and there are no items of exempt business to consider. So we go on to the minutes of the previous meeting. Can I ask if that's agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. So we go on to agenda item three, which is the revised home safety strategy presentation. And I believe Jed Sheridan's going to present it.
Okay, afternoon everyone. So thanks for allowing me to present today. So in terms of a bit of an update for the committee on our home fire safety strategy. So my name is Jed Sheridan. I've been in the post of the Prevention Directorate Area Manager since January, so it's probably quite timely because since January there's been a significant amount of progress that we've made towards the home fire safety strategy and some significant improvements in the way we're delivering our sort of our key messages to the members of the public. So a little bit of a refresh. Obviously everyone knows Merseyside, but I think in terms of the population levels, the area coverage, and also sort of the areas of most significance for us. We know it's an ageing population in terms of increasing in terms of the housing stock, in terms of our infrastructure, it's developing, cities getting bigger, and our sort of area for prevention is growing. So we're acutely aware of that, but equally it's about how we sort of are on top of that and working with partners to make sure that the interventions that we make and the prevention work that we do is targeting the most needed in our communities. But having said that, we realise the scale of the issue with our community size. So where do we want it to be in 2023? As you can see, what we've outlined in our prevention functional plan, which is on the right, is captured and scrutinised within the service delivery plan and more significantly in the integrated risk management plan. So what we're saying is by targeting those over 65 and the most deprived communities in Merseyside, we'll ensure prevention is at the very heart of our service delivery by engaging with the most vulnerable people within our communities. That's the key emphasis, and that's the key of our home fire safety strategy, and certainly moving forward, that's what, how we're going to be targeting our attention. Where do you start? As mentioned before, if you look at the scale of Merseyside and look at the growth of Merseyside, where do we, you know, what sort of key areas of data do we utilise to refine, you know, what was in the past probably quite a blanket approach to home safety? It's becoming a little bit more target driven now and a little bit more data intelligence led to make sure that we're targeting the key people who we need to make those interventions. As you're all aware, Merseyside has some of the most deprived areas within the country. So again, that is quite difficult and it's a challenge, but what we do is we draw upon this type of data and internal sort of data sources as where we're having our fires, where we're seeing areas of antisocial behaviour, so we can target our resources, not just from a home safety point of view, but from a community safety point of view. So we utilise internal data streams, but also what we've learned over the last couple of years is that partner agencies have a host of data sources that from our point of view would be really, really valuable to get that, to make sure that we're making the most of the intervention work that we can do. So what we look at is, if we're looking at those areas of deprivation, we then draw data sources from partner agencies also to make it a much richer picture. And what that finds is if you look and you say, where are we having our fires? And then if you overlay it from where the areas of deprivation, as we've mentioned before, and we say, if you look at across Merseyside, some of the highest in the country, it's no surprise that people like you will probably find where we're having our fires in the areas of highest deprivations. Yeah? When we're drawing data from partner agencies, for example, what you start seeing is knife crime, firearm incidents, domestic violence, properties that have been targeted hardened, i.e. where we've been out of those properties where there's been an attack on the property. Equally, families with complex lives. So part of these data sources that we're taking from partner agencies, what it's telling us is that we're dealing with the same people in many different aspects, so their problems are our problems. So by targeting the right people and by data sharing, we can focus our attention to the right areas, i.e. those who need us most. Does that make sense? So again, sorry, when you look at where we're having our accident, dwelling fires, again, it's the high deprivation areas, but also where we're probably getting information and intelligence from partner agencies. And what we'll come on to later on is what we've captured in our functional plan for this year is to make sure that those data sharing agreements are kept up to date, but also that we're learning and continuing to relearn from incidents that we're having to say what data was missing from that picture, what data should we be capturing in 2023, 24, 25, in this modern day and age where you look and go, some of the issues through COVID of where we've learned, we've become a little bit more agile and we respond equally, so we can actually share data quicker and easier, so we can actually act upon it and actually make those preventions before they become actually like a dwelling fire or something more significant. So that's the aspiration, and again, captured in our functional plan for this year, to make sure that we're keeping those up to date, but also learning and seeing what other information sources are out there that we can tap into earlier. So a key example would be, and working really hard at the moment to make sure we do that, so hospital discharges, or where we know people are have carers, you know, where we can go, actually, is there something that we can do in there? We can target our intervention where they're more quickly. Okay, so that's kind of the areas. What we're also aware of is that, and what we're working nationally is with the National Fire Chief Council's colleagues within our Prevention Directorate, and leading the country on putting this and other programmes of work together. So this is a person-centred vulnerability model, and this is all the aspects of, okay, living in a particular area is probably going to put you more at risk of having a fire, but equally, certain levels of vulnerability, again, is going to put you more at risk of fire. We need to be aware of that. And once you are, once we're cognizant of those sort of factors, then we can draw upon other partner agencies to say, what data sources can you give us, which are related. And there's a whole host of sort of vulnerability statuses that would can impact upon your risk of fire. You know, we'll go through some of these. And these are the areas that, one, we're asking questions on, but also making sure that we can give advice to sort of counteract some of these. Okay, so having said all of that in terms of where we're looking from a data point of view, I suppose so what does that mean to us, and what does that mean to our strategy, and what are we setting ourselves up for this year to deliver? What that means is that we will be completing 50,000 home safety visits a year, that's by our operational crews. We're committing to 10,000 safety well visits a year, that's by some of our advocate work that we do, and we've obviously got specialist advocates who will go in, and particularly around high risk referrals. So some of those vulnerability indicators that I mentioned just previously, we will target some of those groups with our specialist advocates. We will go out and we will mitigate some of those risks. We'll recruit prevention staff who represent the communities that we represent. I'm sure from a scrutiny point of view, you've already looked at previously some of our HR recruitment campaigns, predominantly around firefighter recruitment, but equally, you know, what we're recognising, it's more important and just as important to make sure that all of our workforce represents our community, and we've got a real opportunity of doing that through our prevention work and our prevention youth advocates, and equally some of the work that we do in prevention also in youth engagement work, so that includes Princess Trust, that includes Beacon programmes, again to make sure that it represents the communities that we serve. Introduction of online home fire safety checks, that's when I mentioned before about leading the country in terms of National Fire Chiefs Council, that's a massive piece of work that a colleague is probably aware of, Mark Thomas, who's working within the Prevention Directive. In terms of the person-centred framework that we mentioned, or that I showed you earlier on, also this online home fire safety check. So what you should see in and around June will be the first phase of a rollout of online home fire safety checks. In the main, they're predominantly aimed at people who are of a high risk, but equally it gives people a reassurance that everything in the home they're doing is accurate and consistent with the face-to-face messaging that we give, but also gives us a way of, via use of technology, bringing in high-risk referrals from either partner agencies, members of the public, friends, family, etc. But also for those people who don't meet the threshold of being at risk, giving them a degree of reassurance that actually, yeah, your smoke alarms are in the right place, you're doing everything you should be in terms of, you know, making a fire plan of an evening, closing doors, switching off sockets, etc. And equally being able to print something off and give someone a degree of reassurance, yeah, I'm following it, I'm doing everything I should be doing. But like I say, also bringing in those high-risk referrals for people that are there, for whatever reason, through partner agencies, we haven't had a referral, or it hasn't come from themselves or a friend or family. So that should start in and around June. Launching community safety campaigns for each station. You're probably aware now that from a restructure within this Fire and Rescue Service as of the 1st of April, every station has one station commander. In terms of, as an opportunity from a prevention point of view, it gives us a real impetus now to say, okay, each of those station locations, in line with your station planning process, you've got the ability to coordinate the full resources of the central prevention team at headquarters and give us a targeted campaign within your area. And that really is about knowing the community for the operational crews, the station manager, and equally for us to get outside, you know, and again, there's nothing beats getting across the threshold of someone's door to make sure that we're really putting those messages to those that are at most at risk. And again, really, you know, continuing to work with national colleagues and regional colleagues now, we've got a prevention Northwest group which has been re-established, so we're working with colleagues across the region to make sure that not just our messaging is consistent but from a home safety point of view, but we're learning from colleagues from home safety, but also translated over to community safety, so roads, water safety, because as you're well aware, some of the issues that you might have in terms of road in particular, it might be people from Merseyside, so it's essential that we're delivering those messages across the region and around the country in a consistent manner. Okay. Mentioned before in terms of our functional plan, staff now have got 9 areas of key delivery, which I will be held to account by the Assistant Chief on a quarterly basis, but equally it gives people a bit of ownership in terms of something that, you know, it captures the work and the excellent work that the team are doing. And each of those areas is something that are time-bound, specific, and will be delivered over the calendar year. Okay, so, as mentioned before, coming to roll back in January, we are now fast approaching the end of May, coming into June. So I suppose it's kind of a really good opportunity to look at, okay, how are we progressing? What I do know is that we were, I think, the first, if certainly one of the first, well, in my opinion, I shall say it there, I think we were the first to switch on back to full activity prevention work around the country. We were the first FRS in the country to do that. I think really proud of the fact that we continue to deliver through COVID, but you know, nonetheless, we recognise it was limited what we could do to a certain degree. As of the 1st of February, we switched all prevention activity back on fully. Really proud of that. In terms of,
can I just ask why were we the first, and how were we able to do that?
I think in terms of what was happening around the country, it was a risk-based approach to probably prevention work, protection work, and equally your preparedness work. So chief officers up and down the country were consulting with our chief officer, who was leading from a COVID point of view. Ultimately, it's up to chief officer's discretion in terms of it's a balance against risk, isn't it, I suppose. I think the opportunity through the Strategic Business Continuity Group that the Assistant Chief chairs was based upon advice. We saw it that, you know, the benefit outweighed any risk, and I think that was key in terms of our involvement in internally, but also on the health protection boards around the Merseyside to say, what does the picture look like in terms of what does the risk look like in Merseyside? It may be different from other parts of the country, but from our point of view, I think it was imperative that we restarted prevention work as soon as we could, in addition to protection and also all of our preparedness work, i.e. training. But nonetheless, I think we did an excellent job to maintain a level of activity right the way through COVID. And yeah, it was more risk-based. Certainly when it was, when the pandemic was at its height, it was difficult to sort of ensure staff safety and make sure we got that right balance. But I think the 1st of March seen a bit of a change, really, where we could say, actually, okay, it's not over, but there is more benefit now. And I think we know we're a lot more understanding in terms of the risk of spread of COVID, our PPE levels, our you know, immunity status in terms of the vaccine program. So I think it was an excellent decision to start that off and get back out into the communities.
Yes, so our pre-planning helped us to get us going as soon as we possibly could.
Absolutely, and that's a testament to the business continuity group, really, of making sure that when the opportunity arose and we've seen that we were in a position to immediately switch it back on and say, right, okay, the crews. And in preparation for that, I say part of the planning was we didn't stand still, so there was things that we could do. So, i.e., what you'll have seen in the past, probably paper based versions of home fire safety checks. So, internal development continued through the pandemic to allow, first of February, we switched on electronic devices. I.e. tough pads. So when the crew's now going out and the advocates are going out, they're doing it on a tough pad. And it's a massive advance that, which I'll come on to a little bit later on. Firstly, the data is live. You know, instantly we capture those risks that internally, if that's a high-risk referral from a crew, it's captured by Fire Service Direct, and we can mobilise the advocates quicker than we probably would have for a paper-based version. Equally, I think it looks a bit more professional. And it gives us so much more advancement in terms of if we print off 4,000 forms, and then if we think about, go back to those vulnerability status and equally some of the data shared agreements that we're sourcing now, if there's a question that maybe actually, you know what, we really need to start asking this, then we can adapt it and we can do it electronically. I know it's only a simple thing, but that's made us a lot more efficient and effective in terms of our ability to respond to things and respond to change. So slight change in terms of how we deliver, but a massive advancement for us in terms of capturing data and responding to it quicker. So in terms of quality assurance of home fire safety checks by our advocates and our crews, it's the quality assurance of that. And that was something that, again, we've looked and gone, okay, are we delivering the best product when we're going out? And are we delivering a consistent message? Are we making sure that when we leave, the member of the public that we've had that interaction with fully understands the messages that we're trying to drive home, what the risks are within their particular selves, if it's because of the person-centred risks that they are, or just generic home fire safety advice, and to make sure that it's embedded and understood. So that quality assurance of how we're delivering it, it's probably thrown up some areas that we thought, you know what, we can do that a little bit differently, and making sure that our crews are fully aware of the central message that we're driving, and equally national learning and local learning. So what we've done, again over the March to April period, is we've rolled out online training for all of our operational crews and e-learning, which again, that just reinforces these are the things that you should be talking about, these are the key areas that we need to focus on. These are the areas that we're seeing significant rises in fires, so this where we really need to pay attention to. For all of our staff.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Just in terms of quality assurance then, is that following the home safety check, and how do you measure that?
So we do in-visit quality assurance, i.e. a station manager will go out with the crews and will supervise and will quality assure the consistency of message, you know, the quality of how they're interacting with members of the public. Are we following the full question set? And it's particularly important when we're launching a change in the form to make sure that we're doing it to the right standard 100% of the time. Additionally, what we're also doing is contacting members of the public fire service director to say, did they ask you this? Did they ask you that? What was your, you know, give us an assessment about the performance. So it's following the visit, but also it's due on visits as well. So hopefully we're capturing real learning from there. And again, it's just being able to feed that back into the, you know, what we can maybe do things a little bit differently and being able to respond to it. So in terms of using new technology to learn and deliver different messages to staff and public, there's a little bit in that in terms of how we deliver e-learning. You know, in the past, e-learning used to be, I think the analogy was it was paper through glass. It was a click and I'm just reading the product. That's not e-learning. That, you know, it's got to be a bit more interactive. It's got to be a little bit more, so you actually get something from the product. And I think we've made advancements to that for our staff. But equally, those products that we're using have got another purpose, i.e. we can utilise them, and I'll show you some examples. So the tough parts that I said earlier, where we're going up and we're capturing key data and we're capturing the home fire safety check assessment, members of the public, it's a really excellent tool to be able to show someone and say, you want to tell you about closing your doors of the night? This is why. So here's a video, here's the difference between you closing your door of the night. So that's got twofold advantage. One for our staff, where they're seeing, actually, that's a really good message. That's what we really need to drive home. But equally from in the e-learning, we utilise those products. But when you're going out on a tough pad, if we're seeing a significant rise in a particular type of fire, then we'll tailor that product or that tough pad. So we can show a video and we can show an image of it. Equally, if we've got, I mentioned before, in terms of the communities that we serve, the ability that you've got through the tough pads now is to change it so it's multilingual. So if we're really struggling to communicate with a member of the public, we can change the language on the tough pad to show those messages. So it's been a real sort of step forward having the assessment forms available electronically in terms of our efficiency and effectiveness. It's a massive step forward. So, mentioned before, in terms of how we can now, that data comes in, we can audit and we can scrutinise day-to-day performance immediately. So those reports are available to myself, prevention managers, the station managers, the watch managers. So in terms of how we're performing, that's captured daily. We run a number of reports that again is generated by strategy and performance. So we've got lots of different data and sources that we can draw upon to say, are we achieving over 65? Are we meeting that? Are we actually where we're going out and delivering the home fire safety check? Is it the most at-risk group, like the over 65s and the areas of vulnerability? So we can run a report and we know where we're targeting. It's actually, we're delivering against that. In terms of the tough pads, and again, just talking about them earlier on, that's a big step forward. So what you've seen in terms of the operational crews, they're using them now. Probably June, July, you will start seeing the advocates who are centrally based. They will also be using a similar product. We've got the tough pad, but it'll be a particular product for them in terms of being able to rebook appointments. And as I mentioned, in terms of the online home fire safety checks, that will be complemented into this in terms of we will measure how many people are using the online service also. Okay, so final bit. And I'll pause if I can. So this is a quick, can I just finish that, please? So this is a video. So what we did was, it was a bit of a case study is where it started. So we had a domestic fire where thankfully there was a rescue, and the advice that the crew gave it was the Friday evening, the member of public followed that advice exactly as we wanted it, and thankfully the lady's life was saved. So to paint the picture, and so also to sort of in terms of the advancements that the tough pads and the use of the electronic forms give us, but equally, as I mentioned before, being able to get that product and show a member of the public, that's why we're telling you to close your doors. It's a really powerful message. So I thought I'd just show you this because that's part of the e-learning, but equally when we're going out and communicating to members of the public, this is the type of things that on a tough pad we can go, that's why we're doing it, that's why it's so important. So, yes.
And demonstration, on a domestic property fire, where our crews had attended 3 days ago, and given prevention advice to the occupier on the importance of shutting internal doors when they go to bed, when they leave the house, or at any other available time. Fire crews responded 10:30 last night to reports of, and it also indicated that this lady was in the bedroom behind the protected door. Crews entered the property, fought the fire.
So the lady's husband left the property.
Was carrying out a detailed
and
search.
The only intervention you could do because
came to the compartment.
So mobility.
That they'd been made aware of.
Literally close a bedroom door.
Where the door was shut.
Get out and stay out. Fire crews were there within a couple of minutes. And as you can
see, fire damage to the door. With the door being closed at the time of the fire.
So that the entire rest of the property was devastated. Simply closing that door and that intervention made literally the night before.
And the window was openable. So it was a clean air for the elderly female.
What we've managed to do
breathe
is,
while she was awaiting assistance.
The member of public and the family were involved, recognised, you know, the value of the intervention, and are really keen to get involved in terms of one, sharing the video. We'll do the presentation next month to the chief and the assistant chief in terms of building on that case study, but also using the messages and using the family who were involved to say this is why it's important, the fire could come out, this is what it's all about, and you know, ultimately it did save the lady's life. That's it for me. Thank you. Questions?
My question is, I've never seen what things you do in our GP for Alzheimer's. Now, my next door neighbour runs an Alzheimer's and they moved into a new building. And I think what you've shown there would be absolutely essential for here to know. The other thing as well is that we're all councillors and we report back to our councils. Some of the things you've shown on there have been amazing, of what you've achieved and what you're going to achieve. I'm not going to say what you're going to do, because I know you'll achieve it. So what you will achieve, and I would like somewhere if you could come and do a presentation, maybe to our councils, and let us see, because at the end of the day, we're all involved with our community, and we can then send that message out to everyone. But if I take it back to my council, I may not give it as direct as what say you would give it, so I could be missing out important information. Because I think what you showed us has been an amazing thing, and I fully congratulate you on the presentation. I think it's so useful. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem, sir. Thank you. Thanks for the feedback. That's excellent. And I'm sure we can deliver the presentation yourself, the team, anyone. Yeah. And again, going back, the benefit now of having one station manager who's just solely up on one location is get building those links. So any of the groups that you want it to be delivered to, we can do it. It's not myself, it's someone else. More than happy to do it.
So do we get in touch with you, or do we get in touch with our local fire service?
Listen to me. I can sort that.
Yeah. Okay. And does that go for really going into people's homes or at the fire alarms as
yes,
well?
Yeah. Whole host of different data sources.
So that's my question, because it says on point 8 that you're using NHS access to data at the time of individuals. And I'm just wondering that some of the most vulnerable individuals will not be registered with their data.
Absolutely.
Or there's going to be dirty data in there. So what you're doing to kind of put layers upon layers to say GP data, local authority data, other things, other sources of information.
So see is that it's about the data sharing agreements, and it's not just with GPs, it's with a whole host of different data sources. So the aspiration is absolutely, you know, the more data we can get the better, because all it does is refine our targeted approach better. But you know, it's getting the data, it can be a challenge, and I think I suppose it's now, if there's any good comes from COVID, I think people will become and a bit more mature in terms of data sharing agreements and the ability, it's the data share, not is probably the key phrase at the moment. It's not just from an MFRS point of view, sometimes partner agencies are a little bit reluctant to share, and there's always a reason why we shouldn't share. And I think it was a key phrase right the way through COVID that I can't remember who said it, but it is this data share now. So it's an absolute aspiration, but more importantly, it's captured in the functional plan. So we will do it, and the more data we get, the better.
Okay.
Thank you for the presentation, it was really good. Just following on what Edna said, I think it would be really useful to take it back to our council groups and obviously share this information. And then just lastly, I think the plan is brilliant. I had the pleasure of going out with the crews, doing home safety checks. The work we've done is brilliant, and also, you know, safe systems of work and place for, you know, COVID, and just fantastic.
No, thank you. And just building on that, those campaigns, you know, anyone wants to join those campaigns, more than that, we've had a couple of recent requests, so more than happy to accommodate them. Like I said before, the aspiration is now moving forward, they will be happening more regularly, not just following significant incidents. It'll be generated by the station, so each of the areas you represent, you wish to join, more than happy to accommodate.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Again, I echo the presentation that you brought forward, and even so that I've got to the community authority and but just thinking beyond just the fact on the ability group and that messaging that goes out, has there been any thoughts around the delivery of such presentations or information sort of at a school level, so that there's an interaction from a younger age group feeding back, so that they make their grandparents or their parents aware of those other vulnerable groups, and maybe so then from private sector as well, whether or not there's some sort of links in with business instruction like that, particularly with more people working from home and maybe mixed ages working in the same host, but in the same place where people are working from home as well. And then the other thing is just with regards to that data sharing, just how much data sharing we have with the likes of the energy providers as well, because they have working groups and the groups.
So, energy providers, we've got a really good relationship. I think we've made some significant progress with Scottish Power, it was Cadent. So Cadent have been really proactive, and that link come through local resilience forum work, where you think the importance of sharing. Same as oxygen suppliers, we've got a really good setup there where we're getting that information early, so we know where people receive it, so obviously we can keep that in the system for two reasons, from a vulnerability point of view, but also from an operational crew response point of view, so maybe some risks in here that we need to be aware of. I think in terms of the education, so another part of sort of my responsibility is youth engagement and education. And say it in that way is because we've just rebranded it slightly, so it's youth engagement and education, because it is about sort of not just Prince's Trust work, which I don't know if everyone's familiar with, it's the Beacon Project, it's learning together, it's all the fire cadets, and it's about getting those messages, the right messages, into the family environment in any way we can. So yeah, we're doing it, and again, it's consistent right the way across the directory.
Okay,
yeah.
That's me again. A while ago, well, a few years ago, we used to have, especially in Merseyside, the police, the fire service, older people's voice, and all them all came together and done an open day and shared. Does that still go on now? Or?
Yeah,
I know with the COVID, it hasn't obviously, but I learned an awful lot from it, especially like where you just come along with the a road accident and things like that. And it showed you just pointed out about how the safety belt issue worked, which I would never have thought of in a million years. But I just thought that was a good way of informing. It was like insurance, car insurance, there was all different parties that were doing it. But it was lovely.
There was unfortunately quite a lot of initiatives similar to the road safety campaigns we were going out. And, a lot of that did stop through COVID. The position we're in now is we've got the opportunity to start, and we have started to put some of those initiatives back up again. And again, from an area manager point of view, we're embedded within all the boards around there. So those opportunities, again, it's just about, I think, the idea about coming and speaking to the councillors, it's twofold. That gives us an opportunity where we can, and it might be about Prince's Trust work, it might be about youth engagement, it might be about road safety, but it's developing the relationships where you can go, it might be about home safety, it might be road safety, but that goes back to the data. But where we know it, when we know where we're having our incident, is where we can respond and tailor our response accordingly, and whatever that prevention work is. So it could be community safety, it could be education, or it could be home safety, or a blend of all of it. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Is it
possible to have maybe a mail of the slides?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, sure. I'll be able to send them through. Apologies for the size of it, because it's got a video in, but we've probably got some Dropbox or something.
Okay, so no further questions. Can I thank you for that, Chad? And the recommendation is that we just recommend, and we note the content of the report and the presentation. Okay, thanks for that.
Okay,
we go on to agenda item 4, which is health, safety and welfare annual report. And I think Craig is going to... Safety manager for the service. You will have as part of the pack the paper 01322 that accompanies with the health and safety report, which I'm going to discuss today. I thought we'd put together a short presentation to help visualise and contextualise what's within that report. So I'll just spend 5 or 10 minutes going through this and then take any questions at the end. I'll start just by adding that this is the report of the 2020-21 period. And while there is a delay in presenting this today, assure yourselves as members that the continuation of the management of health and safety, the performance and progressing that through this period has continued. I'd also like to just make a mention to the Health, Safety and Welfare Committee. They are integral in the management and performance of health and safety. The representation within that group, chaired by the Assistant Chief Fire Officer, from trade unions, from occupational health and safety, and from obviously we've got Councillor Grace who sits on it on behalf of the authority. So they are integral in helping yourself and the authority maintain a really positive health and safety project. Okay, so just very briefly a bit of background. We manage our health and safety performance through local performance indicators, and they're broken down into two set areas which falls to myself responsibility. So we do that through workplace review, and that looks after place and people, so accident, injury, etc, etc. And then we do that through road risk also, which is the fleet collisions. Okay, so I'll start by going through the workplace performance for the period of 2020-21, and I'll then move on to road risk, and then I'll cover the peripheral items after that. Okay, so in total for that period, there were 35 injuries to staff members during that period. 27 of the individuals remained in work, 8 booked sick, and 3 returned to work within 7 days. Okay. What that tells us is that actually the majority of injuries are minor in nature, and when we take stock of the fact that we have an organisation of sort of in and around 900 to 1,000 people, and that we work in the business of emergency services, the figures are really low, and again, they do stand up to kind of national figures and national scrutiny. So the workplace review is broken down into a set of about 5 indicators, which I will talk through. So
the first one is operational activity. So this is injuries at incidents to our firefighters, okay? So the red line on each chart is our predicted performance. Now, it's not a line that we aspire to achieve, but we're using empirical data that will give us an indication of where we think our injuries will come out. So over that period, we predicted in and around 22 injuries at incidents. However, we come in at 13. So 13 injuries at operational incidents when you contextualise around 16,000-17,000 operation incidents that we attend. That's quite good. Out of the 13, we only have 4 individuals who book sick. So again, that is really low in terms of figures. And I think you'll find within your pack there is some context around how many mobilisations we undertake, how many incidents we go to, how many miles we cover, etc. So I'm sure you've already read that. So again, that is a real positive, considering the area of work that we operate in. So Workplace Review 34 is around operational training. So this originally was combined within the operational incidents LPI, but a few years back was separated out so that we were different. And again, there was only a minimal amount of empirical data that we could build that upon. The predicted performance target was 4 and we came in at 5. But something worthy of note in this in terms of ops training, and again, as mentioned in the report, is running 3 recruit firefighter courses a year, running core training yearly, off-station exercises, multi-agency exercises, etc. There's a whole raft there of exposure within natural training environments where we undertake a degree of risk. In that period, we've suffered 5 injuries. However, none of them individuals booked sick during that time. So again, they are all small and minor in nature. What that does highlight is a real positive. We've worked really hard over the past few years on building a positive health and safety culture, and that includes reporting. Okay, so the reporting of something that is a minor injury where the individual doesn't go off sick is positive in terms of reporting, somewhere that we probably weren't sort of 5 to 10 years ago. Okay, so the next one we monitor is operational accidents through operational routine activity. So this is the op staff going about their daily business, whether it be undertaking hydrant walks, doing tasks on the station, etc., etc. So again, another positive result. We had 17 injuries across the period, and again, only 4 of them booked sick, which kind of emphasises and underpins that culture and emphasises that minor nature of the injury. So the next 2 we kind of monitor, so for non-op staff, so everybody who's in a non-uniform role, people in headquarters, out on the districts, advocates, workshops, etc.